Hello.
Hello, people.
Hi, howdy, and merry summer. How y'all doing? You are correct, Ashley. It is indeed time for more herbal of burble. Probably.
So I always love that when you ascend into water and it's just like, I guess it's kind of a surface.
So I was going to the mailroom this afternoon to pick up a package, and there were a bunch of like teenagers, like skateboarder teenagers, hanging out, getting high over in the sort of like pool area near it. And one of them was like, excuse me, sir. I'm like, me? Yes? What? And he's like, what do you think of the new Spider-Man game? And I'm just like, and he looks at me and goes, it stinks, right? And I just kind of give him a thumbs up. I'm like, yeah, sure, it stinks. And he's like, see, I told you. Now I kind of wish I'd actually played it so I could have surprised them with a nuanced response.
Yeah, just say Miles Morales is the best Spider-Man we've had in the last 30 years.
I mean, yeah, sure. No argument there. Rick, would you mind sharing your screen, please?
Did I not? Oh, I did. Click. There.
Thank you.
Oh, man, now we can see Zazaldo.
The other amusing thing that happened was that I was on Google Maps viewing Nottingham Castle, and because I kind of have this like little archaeological side to me, and it occurred to me I'd never actually seen the real castle, and on the map I saw something that said furry sticker pole of Nottingham, and I was just kind of like, what? That's not
sure
it is.
Enough.
Yeah, it's like a parking pole, but there's like, I believe they're just printed out telegram stickers that are affixed to it. I didn't recognize.
What's funny is I saw the picture you posted, and I'm just like, oh, there's like maybe 15 stickers on that? That's, why do they name it that? There are random poles here in Dallas that have like 150 furry stickers on them.
That's hilarious.
Like, you'll get layers upon layers of previous TFFs.
That really makes me want to take, like, the main Jonas stickers, print out a bunch, and take them. Like, we do a little walk around Dallas.
Well, I mean, if you come to a con or something, absolutely. If you have the opportunity to print out some of your own stickers, do it.
Okay,
either just to give them away or to sell them at Artist Alley or whatever have you.
Yeah, yeah. Slap them on your luggage.
That's one of those things you can do in Artist Alley that's much more chill because you don't actually have to make anything right then and there.
That would be fun. I feel like All Right Look would probably be a good sticker. Hold on, Fed has requested that I drop the link to the furry sticker pole of Nottingham. I'm annoyed that I looked at all the pictures of it, and I'm annoyed that there do not appear to be any stickers of the 73 Robin Hood characters. That makes me mad.
The ones that are around here, because it's not just the telephone poles, it's like the counters in the fast food lane for like restaurants. They'll like have, you know, like a metal bar along the bottom of the window or whatever, and people will just stick a bunch of stickers on that. And I've seen furry ones, I've seen like fashion ones, I've seen sports ones, I've seen like really fucking cooked memes, like Joe Biden with laser eyes, like Cope and Seeds written on it or something. I'm like, good God.
Well, I expect that more. You know, that doesn't surprise me. I see that all over the place. I mean, that was like a major thing whenever I went to like Berkeley or San Francisco. But I was kind of surprised just that there's like a furry pole. I mean, well, I guess I shouldn't be. I mean, shouldn't be that surprised. I guess it's just a non sequitur. You know, like I'm just You know, it'd be like,
you're just surprised that this weird niche thing you're into is somehow referenced in geography.
Yeah, I'm looking at this. I'm like, is somebody trolling me? Is this really happening? it'd be like, you know, going to the Wailing Wall or like, trying to think of another, you know, the Forbidden City or something, and then seeing like, oh, you know, there's a, you know.
Oh God, you said, is somebody trolling me? And now I'm thinking of like a Black Mirror episode where like people look on Google Maps and things appear or don't appear on their map app based on like their advertising data that they have saved. And like, literally they go out and then those things like do or do not appear.
Yeah, they don't exist.
Like, it's a weird horror thing.
Your reality has been customized based on your preferences.
Yeah.
Please enjoy. And for the terrifying things you can't see, just pretend they're not there, because they're not.
Your reality is customized for your happiness and your enjoyment. Mm. If you do not like spiders, they do not exist.
Yeah. God. But yeah, Jonah stickers would be fun. I might try and do artist alley next year, TFF. I feel like that would probably be, if I, you know, I think I'm talking so far, but like one day, I just do one day and really just powerhouse it and try and, you know, sell a lot. And then.
And by powerhousing, you mean manage yourself in a consistent and even way in which you do not harm yourself in any fashion.
Fall off that.
Right? That's what you mean?
Miller. Artists have to suffer for their art. Yeah. That's how this works.
Don't you guys? Yeah. Don't you guys gotta be fed? Didn't you eat this morning?
I mean,
where's your
I'm
bucket?
Actually, I'm good on that because I just carry around like protein bars and like, you know, trail mix and stuff everywhere. It wouldn't be, you know, my con fare would just be I'll be in my backpack like normal. probably some jerky too, you know.
We go get some of the Buc-ee's jerky.
Oh yeah, didn't have the Buc-ee's experience. Next time, definitely.
Buc-ee, Captain Buc-ee O'Hare.
No, Buc-ee's is it's an American, well, mostly Southern, I think, chain of
Actually, I heard of it.
Oh, you have it? Okay, all right.
Oh, man. I forget who told me about it. Let me see here. It's pronounced Buc-ee's, though. It has a beaver on it, I think it was, or...
Buc-ee's beaver as its mascot.
Mm-hmm. Seen rules.
One of their most famous things is a... puff corn snack that they call beaver nuggets.
I've seen rule 63 of the Buc-ee's mascot because
didn't I tell you guys we have beaver tails?
Wow.
Down here?
I don't think I've ever heard of a furry thing on this channel.
Right.
What about beaver tails?
Oh, I've actually had beaver tails. They're kind of rich.
that's actually a prompt. That's a very good description of them. I call them like rich toast.
Yeah, I've noticed Canadian treats are tend to be a little on the rich sweet side, but that's cool, you know.
Well, I mean, that's why people go to Horns.
Indeed.
Oh man, everybody needs their a Tim Horton caffeine, especially when you work at a call center.
Looking
for some entrance to a cave somewhere.
Nope. Not allowed.
Where are you trying to look for?
An entrance to a cave.
I think I know. Okay. This is one of the ones I think I had to look up because it was very annoying.
Forgiveness.
You want me to give you a hint? I can.
Forgiveness is divine, but.
One of those bunny things at the entrance to the cave? I should be able to spot that.
Yes, but you're looking in completely the wrong area.
Oh, okay.
It's a rather long cave, so the entrance is not anywhere near where you think it'd be.
Rude.
Before the stream started, I ordered a pizza, and it was
I know, my bike.
It's now in the lake.
They said it would be here in 15, 20 minutes. It usually is. Unfortunately, someone got the address number mixed up. They wrote it down wrong.
Hate that.
This is only the second time over, 2 years, I think they did that. And I felt bad because my sister said, "Did you tip him?" He says, "Noops. I'm a Canadian. I didn't tip him." "Where's your Canadian hospitality, dear CC?" And I said, "I didn't mean it."
Frederick says, "Miller, earlier today I saw a post or tweet that said Costco is way better than Bucky's." Okay. People are allowed to be wrong.
Well, the thing is, Costco's like where you go when you need to buy, a pallet of toilet paper or something. You know, it's not really like... Bucky sounds more
It's not equitable.
Yeah. Bucky sounds more like a travel kind of... a combination truck stop and... I don't know. I still have to experience it. I probably should withhold judgment until.
Yeah, comparing Costco and Bucky's is kind of weird. You compare Costco to Walmart.
Yeah.
Or Sam's Club, really.
I mean, it's directly comparable to Sam's Club, but you can use Costco in place of Walmart if you try very hard.
Mm-hmm.
I don't think you can use Costco in place of Bucky's or Bucky's in place of Costco.
True. It's one of those logical paradoxes.
No, yeah, Bucky's does not carry, sliced bread or toilet paper or soup. It does not carry things that aren't, travel meals or restaurant food that's made right there and needs to be eaten right there.
They're different species. They have different numbers of chromosomes.
Yeah.
You can't, those two couldn't interbreed.
I mean, it's like comparing Shell, the gas station, and Red Lobster.
Yeah.
It's like, okay, one is better than the other.
The lobster at Shell really sucks.
I've tried it. Yeah, it does.
It's no good.
Why they tell you not to eat the gas station sushi.
Yeah. God. Gas station sushi. But yeah, I am perpetually from the amount of hype Bucky's has gotten, I am now avidly curious about it. Even if it doesn't live up to my magical Disneylandish expectations, at least I'll be able to say I did it.
You did it.
I've done it. Well, what should I buy there? if I go there to buy one thing, what should it be?
Okay, well, it depends what time of the day you go there, because, their meal stand sort of swaps out. The early in the day, they'll have egg sandwiches. Middle of the day, they'll have barbecue sandwiches.
Mm.
End of the day, they'll have, Salisbury steaks or something.
Well, what I meant was... Go ahead.
I would probably say you definitely got to get a drink. You got to get, just the biggest fucking cup they have, the 128 ounce or whatever stupid size.
Yeah, the size that they won't carry at 7-Eleven anymore.
The size where you're just this is the bucket you use for the fried chicken, right? They're like, nope, that's your drink cup.
Nice.
What I would actually suggest would be the jerky. I usually get the caramel roasted nuts, and then the barbecue sandwiches are usually pretty good.
Hmm.
Federick says, "A cup of diabetes, please." Absolutely.
Why is that not undoing? There we go.
Look, those cups, those 64 ounce gas station refillable cups are mandatory for truck drivers, and I know a weird number of truck drivers now that I'm thinking about it. They all have them. They all have this same big plastic 64-ounce cup that they can just walk into any gas station that's of that brand and pay 99 cents and get that entire thing filled up with sweet tea or Dr. Pepper or whatever have them.
I know two truck drivers.
Do Jonas gets one of those cups and fills it up with coffee.
Oh.
Problem is, it would be drip coffee. I don't know if Jonas would like that.
Well, I mean, I'm a snob, but only when, you know, when the options exist. If I just need to be awake, I'll drink, you know.
Whatever. I mean, or backward.
I was, like, I'd run out, and I had some stuff on order, but, like, I may have talked about this. It was having this weird, like, postal delay bullshit where they were trying to deliver it, and the status update kept saying, like, unable to gain access to whatever the blah blah, which is bullshit because normally the postal guard just has a key. I think maybe they were just, like, there was some error, like it wasn't the usual guy or something. Anyway, so it kept going back and forth until I finally had to pick it up from the post office. But in the meantime, I had actually run out, and I had no brew left, and that was a dangerous place to be for me. So I went to 7-Eleven and got the 7-Eleven brand coffee. And it was exactly like you imagined. But, I mean, I'll do it, you know. God.
Oh, I see what it wants me to do.
I think I still have it. It's like, it's, well, it's 100% Colombian.
Man, it says we're into a caffeine base, don't you think?
Yeah, joking aside, the largest cup of coffee I'm usually willing to consume in a day is probably about 24 ounces. Like, past that, I just don't feel good anymore.
That's still so much.
Well, I don't mean all at once. I mean, like, I'll have, like, half of it. This is what I did when I worked the clinic job. I'd have about half of it.
So, like, what, 3 cups a day?
I mean, coffee cups are 6 ounces, so 4. But, again, you don't know
Miller
what this job
makes
is like.
Heart attack concern noises.
No, but, like, again, this job.
Wow, they have a lot of steps to this one.
Nice. Let me just put it this way, Miller. I needed it for that job. That job was a nightmare. But anyway, and for the record, when I quit, I did cut back to a more normal number. So there you go. Typically, these days, I usually have about 10 ounces of coffee on average. But anyway, I had a point to make. There was a point I was going to make.
What point were you going to make, my dude?
I don't know. Having a junior moment. Chat, what point was I going to make? You're supposed to remember these things for me. Anyway, the point is drink more coffee. Drink lots of it. Often. Oh yeah, that's right. I was gonna tell the story of the place.
Drink plenty of water.
Yeah. Well, yes, actually, do drink a lot of water when you're having coffee. That does actually help a lot, because it'll tend to dehydrate you. But anyway, there was a place up here in Seattle, that I didn't know this served it much stronger than what I was used to. And it messed me up pretty badly. Like, that's how I found out what my upper tolerance is. This is one of the Skylar. This was about 2017. Jad, stop me if I've told this story before. You know how there are, like, coffee shops that are, like, you know, there's the dive where you've got the, you know, they also serve, like, greasy food. You know, and the coffee's kind of like dark roast so-so stuff. There's the coffee shops that are like elitist art housey kind of places. And then there are the coffee shops where, like, they're open, like, you know, they're open like only in the morning, and you get like old ladies having brunch there, and you know, that kind of vibe. And this was the place we went to. I was just, you know, there's one place where we usually have our fix over by the marina, and I was like, let's try the other one. Let's try the one over at the north end. You know, why not? Yeah, so we did. And I got a latte. And it had about 3 times the amount of caffeine that those things usually do. And Skylar and I, it took a little while to kick in. And then we were like, I think we had too much caffeine. And he's like, yeah, I think we did. And we just kind of like, we went Pokemon hunting for a while to kind of just walk off the unpleasant tweaky buzz that we both had. And then eventually we went, so bad. It was so bad. It's such an awful feeling. Then we went to Safeway, and then we went home, and we both conked out because, like, after the high came this massive crash. It sucked. You mentioned the 24/7 places. You know, you don't get that as much up here. I don't know why you think you would, but a lot of them kind of keep, like, really boring hours, you know? Someone rather says, don't forget Solus corporate coffee shops. Yeah, oh, believe me, I've been to the first Starbucks. Starbucks Prime. Starbucks Zero.
I never heard work keeps on talking about Starbucks versus Kim Hortons, because it pretty much feels like that's a theme these days between the U.S. and Canada caffeine shops.
I would have to say Tim Hortons is a little bit better. But that's because Starbucks strives really hard to be very mediocre and just average and safe. You know, that's the best way to put it. They don't do anything too fancy with their coffee. I mean, okay, no, what they'll do is the coffee itself won't be fancy, but all the crap that you can put on it or in it will be fancy. You know, you can get the nuts and the sprinkles and the rainbow swirlies and the caramel drizzle and the, you know.
You know, I just realized when you said that, when I used to work at the call center where I was at, people would volunteer people on the floor to go out and get coffee. And I just remembered that a lot of people like their favorite coffees, too cream, too sugar. I'm not sure that's good or bad, honestly. Or the 2 cream, 1 sugar. I'm pretty sure it's 2 cream, 1 sugar, Ashi. He's just going silent there. I think it broke Jonas.
No, I'm here. I'm just. I was trying to find a picture.
I was like, I think I broke Jonas. That was funny.
I usually do. I mean, it depends. Some of those will switch up, but I'll usually do one packet of like Splenda, a splash of cream, and then maybe like a little bit of Tarani syrup, like usually it's like caramel or, you know, mocha or something. I'm not too picky. If I'm getting cheaper coffee or like average so-so coffee, I'll want to kind of disguise the taste. If I'm getting like fancy coffee, then it'll just be a little bit sweetener. That's it. Says, have you ever seen a tin on an almond? No, but I'm sure I could probably commission an artist for it. Oh, puppy friends. Forest puppies.
this another one in a cave? Let's see. Probably this one.
Now, if you guys are ever up here, we can see the first Starbucks if you really want to, but there is much better espresso place within walking distance of it that I absolutely want to take you to.
All right, I'm back.
Hello.
Got a little snack, because it's getting a little hungry.
Got a little snack. Want snack?
I got some black cherry yogurt that I mixed in some rum barrel aged honey and some granola chunks.
Oh, aren't you fancy and stuff?
Look, ma'am, that's the honey they had at the farmer's market, and I support local businesses.
Oh, very good. Very good. Then I don't
need to get my honey from a bear.
That raises many a question.
When you buy honey at the supermarket, what kind of container does it come in?
Oh, I see what you mean.
Mm-hmm.
I thought you were making some sort of furry joke.
No.
Just bare necessities.
I can't do that. What do you mean I can't do that here? But
you don't have enough space in front of you to set the stuff down.
They have to reselect it all.
Just make a fire.
Do you have any flame weapon? Like any ruby staff or something? If you just have one of those out, it'll melt stuff around you.
Yeah. That'd probably be better. Do you have any extra weapons? Of course I do.
I also like that you're going into a cold cave with no sleeves on.
I have cold resistance on. I ate some hot food.
Leek clearly has like crazy jacked up metabolism. I mean, come on, look at him.
Mm-hmm. I think I said this before, like, Link seems like the kind of person that he looks like that, but yet somehow he consumes like a 25,000 calorie daily diet.
Yeah, yeah.
That doesn't work.
Like, the boy is a machine for food.
Yeah. The real secret is, in all these games, he does the quests for fun, not because he actually wants to. You know, he does it for like exercise. Well, Ganon's out there again. Well, better, he just puts on the fitness tracker.
He just goes for a run around the entirety of Hyrule every day. That's like his daily workout. It's like, oh yeah, you know, you just run 100 kilometers, slay 10 giants, down exactly. Like 30 entire cows down my gullet, you know. NBD.
NBD, yeah. Hashtag keto.
God. My mother did keto. I think she still does it sometimes. She's just not very consistent on it. All those kinds of diets, such fads.
Yeah. Be like me and just drink a lot of coffee. That's the best way to. That's the best way to lose weight.
I subscribe to the fathead thesis. Where it's like, if you know what you're doing, you can eat fast food and lose weight and improve your cholesterol.
Dick's dick.
Doran Ryler says hashtag keto, hashtag healing journey, hashtag life, hashtag friends, traps. Hashtag pure, hashtag exercise. Nah, you need another one on there that's just like hashtag Jesus loves you or hashtag vote in the primaries or something else that just immediately like puts you off of like, oh god, now they're making a political thing. Or a religious thing or whatever.
Jesus. Big Butter Jesus. Miller, have you seen the Big Butter Jesus?
Yeah.
Okay.
Did you know that the Texas State Fair every year, they have a butter sculpting competition?
Nice.
And there's an area where you can walk by in the like arts area for the fair.
Mm-hmm.
Where they have basically like a fridge with windows on it, and you can look at all
the. You're supposed to walk into the trap. Distance.
You can see people make like butter sculptures of the Alamo, or of cowboys, or of big techs, or other random things.
Nice.
I saw somebody make a butter sculpture of the Land O'Lakes logo, which is that Native American woman kneeling holding the butter. They made a life-size sculpture of that out of Land O'Lakes butter.
Nice. That's a lot of butter.
Ow.
That's a lot of butter.
Oh no, Big Butter Jesus got struck by lightning. They had a replacement belt, but
God
wasn't...
was like, I said no idols!
Apparently this one's called Hug Me Jesus. That makes me think of Tickle Me Elmo. Anyway,
fire for that, but there isn't any fire except for that up there.
Is it time for a West transform?
Nah.
What haven't we done in a while? We've done a lot of haunts.
I do not have any explosives.
Damn.
Ow.
Let's explode them.
I forget what Danru even is.
It's Ponbon.
Oh, that's Ponbon. Okay. Oh, it's Plush West.
Shoots a quarter in the
back. Nick the Drago, if you ever forget the commands, you can just do !help! Or !commands.
But shoots quarters in the.
Always read the man page.
I could use this boulder for it.
Hey Miller, random question about Unity, which I could probably just find out myself if I wanted to, but it's better to ask you. Does Unity have 2D or 3D masking?
Yes.
Okay, good. I was curious.
Wait, what exactly do you mean by masking, I guess?
Well, in the case of 2D, it would be like using an image to partially mask off a section of another image.
Yes.
With like an alpha specification. In the case of 3D, it would be using a Boolean intersection of multiple polymeshes to make one appear incomplete or fragmented.
You could do that with shaders. You would not be able to do that with the actual geometry in Bug. Unity.
Okay. I'm just curious. This is stuff I should probably be exploring on my own, but, well, you know. I'm lazy.
Manipulating the actual geometry of models in Unity at runtime is pretty difficult.
Is that because it's processor intensive, or because it's not built for that?
A lot of models just aren't really built for that. And I mean, there's things.
Well,
I would do it would be in code, and doing it in code would be a fucking pain because you'd basically have to be redeclaring every single vertex.
Well, that opens up an interesting question then. Let's say, just for a minute, that you were making a game and you had, I don't know, what would be... You had a window you had to break, that the hero had to break. And,
uh-huh.
And you needed a complete form and also a fragmented form that would fall apart into smaller, you know, chunks. How would you manage that?
I would find the package that does that already. But if I had to make it from scratch, what I would do is I would simply have, I would have a window that is whole and then a window that is pre-smashed. And as soon as you have something hit the window that would cause it to be smashed, you just swap the two models and the pre-smashed one can just fall apart. I know there's technology out there that you can find that other people have built that allows you to break it in a more dynamic and realistic way. I think that was something that LucasSoft was working on when they were doing 3D stuff. So I remember seeing a demo they were giving of some of that technology, and they were throwing this tiny R2 at a window over and over and showing how as the R2 hit different points of the glass, it broke differently.
Nice. Ray says, I'm imagining squeezing Plush West and him squeaking every time until feeling something wiggling, and out of him pops a very angry Mouse West. I'm assuming you mean out of the pouch and not out of, like, the mouth or, like, the chest burster routine or anything like that. I don't know why I think of these things.
See, I was thinking the ear, and I was thinking Mouse West is going to be like, hey, stop it! I'm having a nice time here. It's very roomy and empty.
He's got this little control box in his hand with a remote antenna. Karen says, then you'd have two West to hug. Little Mouse West pops out of the pouch and just sits there. And then when you boop him, a big hand goes to boop regular West, and a little tiny hand goes to boop tiny West.
Mouse West Ratatouille's all the other forms.
Exactly. He has them all in this like Bruce Wayne style garage where they're all just like parked, you know, for him to decide which one he's gonna wear on the, you know, to go to the to fight crime.
I love how you say Bruce Wayne style of garage, and I cannot think of any Batman movie that had a scene where Bruce Wayne looked over his like mini cars or something.
I'm sure.
Because I would think Tony Stark, because it's very, very many times he has a scene where he's looking over all of his suits.
No, I feel like there was definitely a scene.
There was a scene in Batman the Animated Series that did that.
Oh, okay. I'm thinking about it. Oh, no. Flesh eating. Don't eat your fleshes. They have feelings. Haven't you seen, like, you know, every Jim Henson special ever?
We need some more Muppets versions of movies. Huh. If we're gonna keep doing all this stupid crossover bullshit, at least make them fun.
I can't help but wonder if, after Disney acquired the Muppets, there were these like corporate meetings where they were like, we want to do X, Y, and Z, and, you know, whoever's in charge of the Muppets now was like, no, we are not doing anything like that.
Disney's like, our lawyers are powerful. They are not that powerful. No, we cannot do Muppets Titanic.
You know, something occurred to me. I forgot that Splinter's a Muppet. Would he be considered part of Disney?
Is Splinter... Oh, you mean from the 90s movie?
Yes. But he is technically a Muppet.
Oh, because Jim Henson worked on that movie.
Yeah.
Never occurred to me about that.
Is Splinter a Disney princess?
Doesn't that belong to Paramount?
Maybe.
TMNT? I don't know.
I haven't looked into it far enough. I do know he was made by the same team for the Muppets, so I don't know.
I'm pretty sure they just worked on it. They don't have any rights to it.
Yeah. Just like how ILM will do a bunch of stuff, but they don't, you know, they're just considered like, I guess like a contractor or something.
No, we need like... Oh god, I'm trying to think of like what other puppet things are out there that are popular.
Actually,
like Muppets X Randy Feltface, or like...
Yeah, it'd just be easier to go up here instead.
Muppets do Dark Crystal or something.
I would
just
watch
Jim
the
Henson
hell
X Jim
that.
Henson.
Oh my god! Just like they play it straight, you know, it's just like regular Dark Crystal production. Then Kermit's just like, "Hi ho!"
Yeah, it's just Kermit in the background going with all the Skeksis.
The Skeksis think Gonzo is one of them, so they just, like, bring him into the order. And then, like, for no reason, David Bowie and, like, you know, 1980s Mark Hamill show up. I don't know.
Just like says, no, Disney owns the Muppets. Jim Henson Copy is still dependent. Okay.
Ron, I remember seeing Star Wars crossover on TV with the Muppets. It was weird and awkward. Because they did like a really cheap split-screeny kind of deal where Mark Hamill met Luke Skywalker.
Oh, jeez.
Even as a child, I remember
that's the gimmick they went with?
Yeah. Not all of their ideas were A-listers. And even as a child, I remember feeling it was kind of weird and awkward.
Man, they really like these ones.
Yeah, I know.
Yeah. I don't know, but I really like these ones. I love the limitations kind of challenges. Because, you know...
I mean, that was, like, one of the criticisms for the original Breath of the Wild is that the Eventide Island challenge was, like, one of the best ones, but it was, like, only one of them. So
right.
They expanded on that a lot in the DLC.
Yeah. I mean, Link having so much stuff, even with the durability limitations, feels, you know, like you should definitely be able to, like, do this minimalist thing, like this exact thing, a lot, and see how much you can get away with, because it really puts the pressure on you to come up with, like, really precise solutions. Like, you get 5 whacks until that stick is broken, and you don't get another stick. Demon Riley says, now I see people hate these on Reddit. Well, I mean, not to say anything bad about Reddit, you know,
Yeah, you can't say anything bad about Reddit. You can't say anything on Reddit right now because every subreddit's closed.
Oh, is it still closed?
I don't. There's a lot of protesting going on, so.
I almost never go to Reddit unless I'm specifically having technical issues that I can't resolve otherwise on Google. Or very rarely when I'm like trying to figure something out on like Blender. But still, I haven't really been keeping track of the situation over there. But yeah, that's what I heard. That like a bunch of them are closing protest.
Races must have opened back up. Yes, they've been forced back open. Frederick says it might have been better if the shrines also restricted the number of hearts you have. I don't know about that. Then it would feel too much like they're railroading you, and they're like, okay, you have this many hearts and this supplies. There is one solution to this, and you need to figure it out. And that's not what players want to do. They want to actually feel like the work they've done is worth something, even in these shrines.
There's a lot of fire safety rules out there. Not down here.
Wee woo, wee woo, wee woo.
Link, get your fire hat on. Stop this. Stop this madness.
Stop this madness. I'm causing this madness.
Oh! You're a hero, Link. I looked up to you.
Medicine, let's stop each other. Rivers run blood, red with the blood of my enemies.
Video games have gone mad this day and age.
Thank you.
next one. Is it possible to destroy that thing? No.
Probably not. So.
Unfortunato, I do not think that is possible, sir.
I guess the other one's outside somewhere.
You know, it's around.
Music kind of gives me Donkey Kong Country feelings.
I'll see it. Jonas has died.
Uh-oh.
Jonas has undied.
Hello?
Hello.
Yeah, hello.
What the hell was that? Hold on, let me join the video. Okay, there we go. I don't know what the hell happened there. It just, the whole frickin', the whole business just gave out on me. It was Ray.
It was me. My thing's cutting out on me.
Yeah.
It was Ray.
There you go.
Just had to speak more steady and not so screechy. Had to stop being so bird.
You can no more stop being verb than you can stop flying. You are verb eternal. Never unverb. No one will ever let you change.
Never unverb.
No one will ever let you change your species. I've tried.
Oh, I see you speak from experience.
Just when I thought I was out, they pull me back in. I probably could, but at this point, I just don't give a shit anymore. But yeah, I distinctly remember, like, at one point, I was like, I remember saying to a friend, yeah, I've been thinking about maybe changing to, like, coyote or something. And my friend's like, no.
I mean, okay, I would not be opposed to you changing. Coyote doesn't seem like the one.
Yeah, that seemed to be the consensus among my friends at the time. This was about 15 years ago.
You're not rascally enough. I need you to be like 30% more rascally.
What does that mean, though?
I don't know.
I mean, I'm pretty chaotic. What's, you know, what would be more coyote-ish characteristics?
You're more goofy than chaotic.
I mean, West gets to be like 15 things. Why not me?
It's because I am like 15 things. It's manifestation of my undiagnosed ADHD.
Oh. That, all right. It says Jones isn't a rascal. He's a gremlin. Yeah, I've heard this too. Although I'm not clear on the difference.
Jonas, we should make you a gremlin.
Like, what would be more rascally behavior?
Like the ones from Magic.
What's from Magic?
They're little like aardvark looking things.
Is that what hold on, let me see this. Well, Magic the Gathering Gremlin. Let me take a look at this. I don't like that. What is that? Why do they have four arms?
You know, because...
Why are they hairless?
Those are gremlins.
That. No. Fire
like burrowing
them.
Aardvark.
That looks like one of those... one of those Jim Henson Muppets from Star Wars, I think.
Yeah.
It kind of does.
Or like that thing that Zorg had on his desk in Fifth Element. I don't like that. Take it away. Take it away.
All right. We'll make you a gremlin.
I don't know how to make me a gremlin. I'm a rascal.
We just said you're not rascally enough.
He's slightly rascally. He's rascally enough to be a raccoon.
That's right.
That's true.
Yeah. I could make Coyote if I tried really hard and maybe studied nights, you know what I mean? People make changes like that all the time, you know what I mean?
You know what? I totally believe in you being able to improve yourself and make yourself the person you want to be.
Oh, no.
I don't know if Coyote is the person you want to be.
Oh, okay. No. I see how it is.
Look, you're not like a partier. You're not like kind of person who just like goes around and it's like truth or dare everyone because you want to just get up to weird shit.
Is that what Coyote? All right.
That's what I imagine coyotes do. Is they just like they get into way too much trouble because they go way too over the top with like practical pranks and stuff.
I probably just wanted to scare you at night.
Yeah, do you think I could be a coyote? Say yes.
Absolutely.
So wait, now I'm really curious. What are like raccoon characteristics?
Raccoons have like... I mean, they're usually just kind of like... what you think of like the pudgy side character in a Saturday morning cartoon where they're sort of just comic relief and
well
love food to an addictive point.
I've had three rules when it comes to raccoons. It's that they bend the rules, they dig in your trash, and everything is free game.
I see how it is.
There's like the three North American trash mammals. You got your raccoon, you got your skunk, and you got your possum.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
What about weasels?
Weasels? Those aren't trash animals.
Yeah. Nah. Weasels will just straight up like
steal your corn.
No, they're like
they will bite
small.
You. They are ankle severers.
Yeah.
They are not nibblers. They are not biters. They are severers.
Yeah. No, I mean, like, you ever watch a weasel, like
sever your food from your face.
Yeah. Simon's got it right. Weasels are murder tubes.
Murder your food.
The only way to placate a weasel is, like a ball pit. Or like a box full of happy peanuts. Yeah, there's Stout West. Right on time.
Chet's like, oh, you mean this blushy boy?
Yeah. Oh yeah, right. Brought out the alternate versions of Jonas, yeah.
See, I can see Red Panda or Tanuki, but maybe that's only because they're like sort of like raccoon already, so it's easy for me to see that.
Die. I'll just be chained to this forever. I can never escape. It's my legacy. It's like when a musician wants to completely change his style and go from like country to like electronica or something, and the fans are just like, "What's he doing?"
Radical, become a dolphin for a while, says Astaroth. Ooh, dolphin be interesting. But you'd be like a freshwater dolphin, I think.
Why? Or did you mean near?
That's the idea that goes in my head. It's like you'd be a dolphin, but you'd be a freshwater dolphin.
I don't know.
I don't know. That's just what brain says.
I can be pretty salty.
I don't know why brains say thing. Brain's sometimes a little stupid, but that's what brain says.
Did you have a bird moment?
All of my moments are bird moments. Come on.
That's fair.
The only not bird thing I am is, like, entranced by shinies. Races squinch the stoat. Squinch.
Oh, you squinch the stoat? You squinch the stoat like Charmin toilet paper?
Ew. Just kind of like, just give him a squeeze. Yeah, he's fresh.
Yeah, fresh. You don't want your toilet paper to not be fresh.
Foxer says, if I had changed my fashion, I'd probably do something like this. He's like, I knew somebody who had a hybrid dog slug character.
Mm-hmm.
Like, top half dog, bottom half slug. That's it.
Did they get to that point by undertaking bottom surgery?
Yep. Nice. No, I think that, like, originally their character was just a dog. And then I think they decided that they wanted something more unique, or perhaps less, you know, less commonly appealing. Maybe, I don't know. I don't get it myself. I mean, you know, I picked the most pedestrian species I could think of.
The most pedestrian species.
I mean,
raccoon is not like the most common thing.
Well, I mean, pedestrian in the sense of like ordinary, you know, not like. The most common thing, I think, for a long time was fox. Or maybe husky. I don't know if that's still the case. Probably not. But
I would think it's wolf, probably.
That makes sense. everybody, like back in the day, everybody was going like wolf, dragon, lion, wolf, dragon, lion, fox, husky, you know, some felines. Where some folks would just have the species of toon. He just kind of luged down the cliff face there. I love that. Oh, a lot of tigers too. That was a real popular one. Lots of tigers.
I know. I need that silver moblin horn. Come on.
Didn't get a lot of kangaroos. Lots of mice. Lots of rats.
Yeah, kangaroo is a more uncommon one.
But that's a good point, Boxer. Dragons were really popular for a while.
Dragons are like the S-plus tier. But then everybody realized, you know what? If everybody was a dragon, it wouldn't be unique anymore. I remember when I was first on the internet and I was saying people started to make avatars, custom avatars. I said, well, geez, I don't think everybody would be a dragon because then it'd be too popular. Bam, press the button. Everybody's Flangermon and all sort of weird dragons over here. Like, yeah, mainly Flangermon. What am I saying? Everybody was Flangermon.
And when everyone's Flangermon, no one will be.
Nope. Let me see, what else was there? Okay, it was actually Cell, Flangermon, and I'm trying to remember whatever characters. People were very popular picking back then. But it was definitely dragons all over the internet back when I first started. Like, right around the 1998, I think it was. That's when I first started seeing this.
God, we're old. We're old.
I wonder if one of these actually has a cave inside of it.
Forms, that's right. Oh man, a lot of forms. He was getting out of style. Surprising was a format. It just literally called "Come Be a Dragon" form. Don't pop age.
You'll get there.
We'll all get there one day.
Be older and wiser while you're at it.
Oh, GC, I wish that were true. I wish you just got wiser when you were older.
Yeah, I was going to say, don't know about wiser. I know more things. I know more facts.
You just got transmitted to us the wisdom, guys. I mean, don't let it get to you or anything.
I'm generally more mellow. I don't know if that equates to wiser.
You're just a mellow yellow.
Exactly. Uh-uh. I am just a mellow yellow.
There you go, man. Take a sip of water.
Or coffee, in my case.
If it'll make you wiser, go for it.
I think I've already been here, even though... Yeah.
Jonas is a fighting character. Basically drinks coffee as a power move.
Yeah, it's my buff elixir.
Yeah. And what does it do during a fighting game when he drinks coffee? Makes a... Let's
speed
see.
Boost. speed boost, but you also have to like roll sanity.
But he drinks too much coffee. He's too fast to play.
Yeah.
That's another one in a cave.
That's another one. That's another one.
I've also sometimes thought that, like, I need to change up Jonas's look a little bit because I've had the same palette and look for about 20 years. But I can't think of anything to do that wouldn't feel weird and outlandish.
I mean, kind of changed it a little bit, haven't you? Like, you've sort of gone between a more tan and brown color scheme to a little more gray.
Hold on, let me pull up the old page. I have an evolution of Jonas picture. Yeah, the character used to be very brown up until about 2001-ish. I think since then, it has not changed very much. Gotta hit my whole heart. Take it away. Take it away.
Is that what those things do? Ow.
Oh, the big flower petal islands?
Yeah.
Or I should say the small flower petal islands. Kinda wanna take a picture of the text.
The text? Oh, you mean in the game?
Yeah. Because it says it's written in an ancient Hyrulean. You cannot read it.
Yeah, I have to take it to the annoying guy.
I hate that guy.
Well, not the annoying guy.
Well, Miller, how many annoying people can there even be in Hyrule?
A lot. There can be quite a lot.
You speak from experience.
Yes, after having, 215 hours in this game, yes, I think I can say from experience I've experienced many annoying people.
Fucking job.
What did you say? Did you say get a job?
No, I said that's like a job, but you should get a job, you loser. God, Gen Z.
Wow.
What's with you guys? Y'all just want to, like, hang out on the internet with furries and, play Twitch games and,
Chat, I'm going to need you to cancel this man right the hell now.
I'm uncancelable. No one can cancel me. I'm already cringe.
Gasp.
And Bogger's like, no. Oh no, I've been bopped. I've been bopped by the cancellation hammer. I guess.
Yeah, what you deserve.
I am chastised. BRB, deleting Twitter.
Oh no, he got offended by one thing, now he's deleting all of Twitter. Oh no, how terrible.
He was slowly reaching for a delete button on his account. Like Ren Stimpy style. Flo cancels Jonas's credit card.
No! How else can I make irresponsible purchases?
For a guy that just likes to play games all day, I'm strangely responsible with my purchases.
Yeah, I... Honestly, same. I've learned to get really frugal. I get a little frivolous, like, you know, during Steam sales, but that's, you know.
Not only that, though, but the thing with me these days is that I feel like I learned enough about video games that I can take a break for a change. I play just for friends now.
That's fair.
I used to basically play games not only just for fun, but for educational purposes, but yeah, now it's just hanging out with friends.
You know, it's funny. The last few years, you know, with this whole thing, has really made me, I think it's really made me much more interested in the craft aspect. I said that like it's craft beer or something. But like, I definitely think making one is gonna happen. Like, don't know when. Don't know how. But, you know, it's gonna happen.
One of these days I hope I can do it too, Jonas.
Wait, sorry, what did you say is gonna happen?
I'm gonna make a game.
Jonas is gonna go out there and make a trash panda game.
It's not gonna be like a groundbreaking, mind-blowing game, but...
I mean, hopefully in 2 weeks you're gonna make a game.
Well, yeah, I mean beyond Game Jam. Not that I'm not gonna enjoy the hell out of Game Jam. But I meant like...
He's gonna make a Steam game, it's gonna be popular, break the internet, okay, no.
Oh, I just thought it'd be fun to like... You know, make something that is fun. Simple, fun, you know, kind of...
Oh, yeah.
Draws on the 8-bit aesthetic.
Fun story. My cousin from Alberta, when we first...
You're gonna be very happy with what I have to say tomorrow, Jonas.
Okay. Well, my cousin from Alberta, a guy that got me the game in the first place, he showed me RPG Maker, and he was talking about how he was going to make a game. Unfortunately, like, responsibilities in life pretty much done that kind of thing. So I tried it, and it was pretty fun, but then I had the same problem as him. Then House Pets, the House Pets forums, we tried it too. Granted, while that didn't work out either due to the same reasons as everybody, like responsibilities, the thing is, though, over the years, when you think about it, when you think about these little projects, like for game making, a simple thing like that could really come out something wonderful if you put enough effort into it when you think about it. Never let anybody tell you otherwise, because it definitely can work. It's just a question of, like, do you think it'll work, and do you think time and effort will work? And yeah, it will totally work, in my opinion. And there's no I in team, no matter what people tell you.
Yeah, because then it would be pronounced T-I-M. I've had a few ideas for like interesting possible game mechanics, although these ideas exist in a bubble. Like, I have no idea how much of an ordeal it would be to code them. So, you know, that's... It remains to be seen, like, where that would go and how.
Mm-hmm. What I... Two things I want to try someday, if I ever get back into the groove. I want to try directing a video game, because I think I'm really good as a director, even though... Part of the trick I find with directing is that it's not so much that you have to know insides out of everything. You just got to know how to get the project moving. Mm. That's really what it's about when it comes to directing. Nobody, they joke about how directors don't do anything on a project, but a lot of people underestimate the power of directing.
I'll be honest, I don't actually know what a game director does.
Just make sure that everything is going
smoothly. A game director needs to be able to basically correct for everything. If any of your under teammates, your like leads or your developers, your artists or whatever, say, I don't know what to do for this thing, the game director needs to have an answer for them. No. Right?
Okay.
They're meant to be more like the break of the analysis paralysis and be just like, okay, but here is the actual like core design decision we need. These are the like the 4 or 5 details that need to be most exemplified in our design, and these are the ones that need to sort of guide our decisions. And so when you ask me, do I do X or do I do Y, the director is then like, oh, we'll do the one that more exemplifies this pillar.
Or he just say Y.
Yeah, see, that's why I don't know if you'd be a great director.
Oh, come on. I think that's one of the critical points of a director these days.
I already know. Go ahead, sorry.
No, sorry, you go ahead.
I was just saying, I already know for the jam that, like, I will not be married to any idea I have. I'll throw it out there. You know, I mean, there's always a whole slew of, you know, I always draw a couple cards from the deck whenever.
I would honestly say the opposite. Not that you need to marry your ideas, but what I would say for jam especially, because, like, the number one biggest pillar in that thing is speed. You need to be able to make a decision and just be like, yep, that's the thing I'm doing. I'm just going to go with it. I'm not going to think back on it later. Like,
okay, well,
if you say you're not married to your ideas, then what you're going to end up doing is going back and redoing stuff you already did, and then you're never going to move forward because you keep trying to perfect this one little thing.
Well, my question is, well, that makes sense in a solo situation, like when I'm doing art. How does that work in a group?
You need to be communicating with people constantly. You need to be working along with people, and you're just like, hey, this thing is not working out, or I can't get this thing to work like this, or I don't know how to draw this thing like this. Can we do this in a different way? Can we make this feature different? Yada, 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 yada.
Okay.
I'm at 126 shrines.
126?
Yes.
And it's what, like 153, I think?
152.
Or? Okay.
There are 120 on the ground and 32 in the sky.
Getting there. We're getting there.
Let's see. Where's my...
You get a little prize for all the shrines, like a little golden poops or whatever?
Yes, you get a prize, but it is way better than a golden poop.
Okay, that's fair.
I will say, for getting all of the light roots, you just get a little thing that says, thank you for getting all the light roots. But for getting all the shrines, you get an actual, like, gameplay thing.
Oh. Like some gear? Or that'd be spoilers. Never mind.
I don't want to give specifics.
Okay.
All right, I'm back.
Okay.
Doodle says, so there's at least 2 more shrines? Yes, there's at least 2 more shrines.
Nice.
There's a little more than at least.
Dun, 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 dun.
Well, that looks like a place for shrines.
I bet you say that to all the shrines.
No, no, you're special. I'd say only to you.
Aww.
I'd never say it to every shrine.
Miller, I'm curious. Without spoiling anything, were there any parts, any shrines, any challenges, whatever, where it was so frustrating you wanted to quit, or did you never feel that? Like, just flat out, throw the controller, put away the game.
Not throw the controller. I think the most upset I ever got with the game was... No, I can't do that because Rick hasn't faced one of those.
Alright, fair enough.
There's a couple of shrines that it's just like, man, how the hell are you supposed to find where the entrance to that cave is? On your own.
Elbow grease.
I mentioned just Rick one time, but I remember one of the worst things about games with an open map.
Low on energy, but it won't restore until I actually finish it off.
Fine.
Or yeah, definitely when I was looking at equipment, and I was like, you need frickin' how many amber? What? Because I was looking like, okay, what would it take to like upgrade everything? If I wanted to put if I wanted to have every piece of equipment and upgrade every piece to level 4, how much materials would it take? And it's like 30,000 rupees, like 800 amber, like 150 of every other gem, and I'm like, fuck this. No, that's why I did duplication glitches. Because I'm like, this would be a ridiculous waste of my time to just be mining stuff.
You cheated like a cheaty cheater.
I don't care.
They could have set those things to be a tenth of the same price, and they would have put in as much effort as I do.
I'm just giving you shit.
No, like I said, I think this is part of that thing where the new designer on the series... He's done MMO stuff. I think he specifically designed it. He's like, this is a game people are going to be playing for 6 months. So let's make it in a way so that they can play it 4 hours a day, every day for 6 months. And only then can they get all the materials. And it's just like, no, not doing that. I already spent 200 hours in this game. I don't need to spend another 1,000.
God.
And you know what? I had a good time because of it. I don't feel like I lost any fun or enjoyment out of the game for not having to sit there and mine shit for hundreds of hours.
What are we at so far? Let me take a look at Twitch trying. Here's Oh the Kingdom, 93 hours. 41 streams. We have been in. We've been playing it for about 5 weeks. No, fingers. I actually can't blame Miller for feeling that way. That is a long commitment.
What? All right, everybody else go away.
Well, see you later, folks. No.
Hey, everybody. I think for a game like this, I might try and grind it all, even if it meant, like, you know, going for a long, long time. But that's probably because I've gotten, during the pandemic, I got used to stuff like that, where I was like, okay, you know, I'll just commit to this for a year. It'll be fine. Well, I won't be doing much else.
Get the Vince McMahon version of Boom Shakalaka out of my head. Wow.
So many rocks here.
Do 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 do.
Says, but think of the bragging rights when you can see you got every Korok and thousands of gems, upgrade every armor, and you did it all legit. Like, I've done games like that where I've done the hard work and I've gotten all the things, and like, nobody gives a shit.
I mean,
spoiler alert, nobody fucking gives a shit. It's not worth your time.
I mean, probably somebody gives a shit, but you might not ever interact with them. No, for me, it's more like if it means I can get an edge in combat that's worth the trouble, then yeah, I'll do that, you know?
Yeah. For me, well, then that's a gameplay mechanic. That's not just doing it for the sake of saying you've done it.
Yeah.
Well, I don't look at achievements like that. Like, I look at achievements more. I don't really like going for 100% unless it's like Resident Evil or a Capcom game. So easy. Or quick time, I should say. But to do that for a game.
I've done 100% of the achievements on Elden Ring, and I didn't do any, like, cheating or anything in that. I did that because I wanted to experience all the unique content in that game, and following all the achievements is a good way to sort of cross off a list of what is all of the content.
Mm. That is true.
In this game, that's not quite the same when it comes to mining the resources over and over. Like, you've already broken apart every ore thing you've come across as you've gone across Hyrule to do every shrine or whatever. Like, but you're still not gonna have, you're gonna have maybe a third of the total amount you need by the end of that. And it's like, okay, literally I have nowhere new to go, and I still need to go over this whole world two more times. No, there's nothing new there.
That's fair. I mean, that is, yeah.
For me, achievements is just something that the designers of the game put in, like, personal rules for you to see if you figure this and that out, to be honest, though, for me. But it does, for games like Elden Ring and other large-scale exploring games like Skyrim, where it at least gives you a set of soft rules, I should say, to figure out everything in the game. But I personally, when it comes to playing like games like Final Fantasy or Resident Evil, it's more like, what would be the optimal, I should say, thing for the hero to get through, to get to the end game, like get all the treasure, get out of the mansion as soon as possible, that kind of thing. Mm. Story wise, make it the optimal experience.
I can get behind that.
Mm. The game I still say to this day that pretty much cemented that kind of thing for me was Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic. Oh man, I loved that game.
You know, I never played that one. I've heard people praise it.
It's old now, but back then, people just loved all the different choices you could make in the game. Like that's what was beautiful about the game. And it had voice acting for it and everything. And they really put a lot of effort in, like, go down this route, go down that route, and what would the Jedi say about you? What would your love interest say about you? It was funny also hearing Jennifer Hale flabbergast her when you try to romance her character. I was laughing at that. But for a game like that back then, it was just, I loved all the dedication you put into multiple paths in that game.
Nice.
These days, it's pretty done to death, though.
Well, yeah, I mean, these days, you know, branching paths are standard. Back then, it was a lot more of a novelty.
Mm-hmm. And Star Wars is pretty much the standard, like, very easy to tell which was the good and bad path in this game. But everybody loved how humorous the bad path was in that game. Hello, HK47. I'm looking at you, or AK47. I'm looking at you, buddy.
I will be right back, BRB.
127.
I don't think there's anything else back here.
We're getting closer and closer.
Where all the time flies.
Let me go back and figure out what what's up with these over here.
Hello, Chaotic Durg.
Back. Chaotic Durg.
Hello.
That is a sparkle horse.
Sparkle horse.
Disgusting. Amazing. Amazing work, boss. That's why you're the best.
It's the Metal Gear meme of being like, boss, you just killed children. Amazing job! That's why you're the best!
That's why you're the boss.
Yeah, Arcus Felsen, that's what I'm talking about. Fucking silly bug.
Yeah, for me, it's like either really powerful weapons or maybe like really cool unlocked content, like an entirely different ending or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Other than that, I don't give a shit. All of my friends were playing a game and we were all trying, you know, and we were all trying to like get achievements, then nah, even then I wouldn't care. I don't have a lot of competitiveness. What I'd probably do at that point is just be like, let's form a squad. We can all go, crawl the dungeon.
Wow, what up?
Boing.
Yeah. And what better way to play? Sorry, go ahead.
If Pokemon had achievements, what kind of achievements they would have?
Yeah, they didn't really do. Well, okay, no, they do have quests in Pokemon Go that are sort of like achievements. They had some. I mean, they probably still have them. They have like multi-part deals where you have to catch like different types of Pokemon. and you can get, like, I remember you could get, like, limited edition crap and stuff like that, you know, get an interesting hat or whatever. I was never super into it. Mostly because, like, they cracked the whole biome thing and determined, like, what regions in a given map space correspond. I mean, some of them are really hard. Like, some of them would involve me, like, trucking all over Seattle to get shit. You know what I mean? Like, there'd only be, like, a few parks that would, you know, here and there, you know, that would correspond to whatever zone. Basically, I'd have to be like, okay, I'm going to go to this marine park and wait all day and just hope maybe, you know, a Gflurgus spawns or whatever. You know, with its, like, 5% spawn rate.
Hate those Gflurguses and their 5% spawn rate.
You know what I mean.
Yes, I know what you mean. Just giving you shit, Jonas. When have I not given you shit?
Yeah, it's such a bird thing.
Well, why do birds like to do that?
Just an it's an unending torrent of bird shit. Much as real birds are ought to do.
You ever see that footage of the shark? Like, the shark's like swimming past the people, the person in the cage. And then the shark drops a deuce, and it's like fluorescent green.
Yeah.
Could you just imagine what that smells like? I mean, I guess you wouldn't be able to smell it because it's water.
Think you could.
But if it was on land, could you just imagine what that would smell like?
Yeah, it'd probably smell awful.
I mean, fish are already kind of ripe smelling, you know. Let's all take a moment and just think about that.
No, you know what? I'm immediately moving this on. Hey, chat.
How's everybody doing in the chat tonight?
For those of you who have played Tears of the Kingdom and have a favorite shrine that we have done already, and isn't spoilers, what's your favorite shrine? If you remember the one.
Miller's just like, moving on!
Moving on. My favorite was the one that it looks like a blessing, but then actually becomes a real puzzle. I like that. I like the idea of a troll shrine like that.
Further question. Do you think we can, like, just smash the sword stronger? I think that's a thing.
Yeah, you can. You can fuse stuff to it.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, besides fusing, but okay.
In the Breath of the Wild DLC, you can, but I don't think there's a way to in Tears of the Kingdom in just, like, the base game.
Why do you, like, have glowing eyes?
As I have on the Fierce Deity mask.
Fierce Deity set.
Right.
Not the mask. Yeah, don't you know? He can walk through walls, disappear, and fly. He's much more unique than the other guys.
No, I'd forgotten. About this one because it's from Majora.
Just hit him with the Danny Phantom.
Nice.
Sunrising says, Unlit Blessing was my favorite too, especially since I missed the shrine's name initially. Yeah, no, I wasn't paying attention, because I got that one much later when I was just going through trying to find the ones that were in caves and stuff, and so I was getting through a whole bunch of them in a row that were blessings, because they're inside a cave and the idea is finding them is a challenge. And then I hit that one, and I just ran up the steps to go get the thing in the chest and then go get the shrine. I didn't even notice the like torches that were lit around you, and then I almost walked off the edge when the platform moved away from me, and I'm like, what?
Nice.
It's great. I love when games like this can surprise you. You know, they have so many mechanics that honestly can sometimes feel repetitive, and I love it that they recognize that and they try to throw in a few curveballs here and there.
I feel like you have to in a world this big. You know, I mean, otherwise it would get boring.
I mean, you don't have to. You can't just have it be boring. There are many a game that are just boring. But yes, if you want to make your game good, yes, you need to have. Take chances to throw curveballs at your player.
Yeah.
I want to fight Gliok, so I'm doing that now.
Do it!
Time to fight Gliok!
Get on it!
I wish you could get on it. Unfortunately, you cannot get up on the Hydra's back.
Miller got that meme in his head nonstop.
Even though you're quite literally fighting it. Well, almost literally fighting a Hydra.
And you pet the Durgan.
What weapon do I have?
Maybe about the dragon?
Did you see the thing that somebody made where they're like, okay, you can't press a button to press the dogs in this game. So what I did is I made a machine that has a giant hand that like swings up and down, back and forth, and it pets the dogs if you place the machine in just the right position.
Nature found a way.
Dog's like, huh, I'm feeling something, but I don't know what it is.
Yeah.
I do find it funny that many people have just taken that thing to literally meaning can you pet the dog in X game, when it was not literally about being able to pet a dog in every video game. It was about being able to interact with characters in the game in a non-violent way. Because there was a point in, I think it was like Call of Duty, or was it like a Tom Clancy game or something, where you saw dogs and literally the only way to progress the level is to shoot them, and it's just like, can you not? Or no, I don't even think it's you can't progress. I think it's they're like off to the side and they're barking at you through like a chain link fence, and you cannot do anything to them except shoot them.
I want to make
it's just
a game.
Like, why?
I want to make a game where that's where you shoot them and they react like you're petting them. Just like, aw, they wag the tail. It's, you know, it's lead petting.
Yeah, you need some kind of sci-fi game where you're shooting like electric zappy guns at people or enemies or whatever, but the dogs are all robots and so they just get like a charge out of it.
All right.
I'm going way too high in the air.
Yep. So the Gliaks have three phases to them. The first phase is they're on the ground and you can just kind of shoot them or as is. Second phase, they're floating a couple feet above, and you have to find a way to bring them down. Third phase, they're gonna have some big attack that then allows you to get up to them. And then you have to make them fall again. So, there's actually two times I was very aggravated at this game, and both of them were from Glioks. One of them was because I was trying to fight a Gliok and I had no arrows, and I was just like, okay, what's the game design here? I have no arrows, how am I supposed to fight a Gliok? And I kept trying different stuff, I kept looking at different things, and it's just not physically possible to fight Glioks in any way if you have no arrows. They break apart all of your built things. They have the like wing guts that constantly push you back so you can't melee them, and like they have so much health and take so little damage if you're not crit striking them that you have to strike the heads in order to knock them down. And I'm just like, what, why the fuck? Why is there no other option? Why is this the only way to fight these guys? I want to use my abilities in fun and creative ways, and you fucking make them in such a way that you cannot do that. Game, why?
It doesn't torture you, Miller.
Just like, ah! Again, this is the thing of, like, when you had the bombs in Breath of the Wild, you could never truly be out of damage sources. And there was never any enemies in Breath of the Wild that just said you had to only use melee or could only use ranged. But there seems to be a lot more in this game that are like that. It's upsetting.
keep rewinding it.
You can only rewind it back to the furthest it's been rewound.
You can rewind as far back as perfectly humanly manity it can be.
It looks like the game's just kind of like the don't run out of arrows to begin with. I know, and I get that the intended thing there is probably they're supposed to run away, get arrows, and come back again, but I'm just like... That seems like... It's just a big pile of suck that you have to be like, well, I guess I run away now. Alright, Rick, you want me to give you a hint for this? Because you keep going back and forth over the same area.
Yeah.
It's not up here. It's in the big canyon.
I was afraid of that. I wanted to run out of options up here.
Marcus Vell says it's pretty fair. It's pretty difficult to run out of arrows if you use up all the game's mechanics. It is easy to run out of arrows, though, if you fight three or four Gliocks in a row because you're trying to farm Gliok guts.
Gliok guts. Who doesn't like Gliok guts?
And each Gliok takes like 75 arrows, so even if you have a good supply of like 300 of them, you're gonna run out.
Yeah. Did you think about that? I don't think so.
Literally fall right on top of the guy I'm looking for.
Nice. Yep. It's very annoying too, because if you walk along that road on top of the cliff, your sensor will go off. It's just high enough or just close enough that you can detect it, and it's just sucks a lot. This one is very hard to find.
It's just
Ray says, in all Zelda games, you really need something like bombs or arrows or magic for a boss fight. Either extra enemies or the boss's attacks would drop them, or there'd be something respawning in the arena. Yeah, but that's when you have a more, you know, normal Zelda game boss fights that aren't Breath of the Wild or Tears of the Kingdom. You're in a boss arena. You can't leave until you defeat the boss. Therefore, they want to make sure you don't, like, get softlocked because you don't have any more arrows or whatever. In this game, it's not the same case, because you can just walk away from every fight. Besides... two? I think there's two fights you can't walk away from, and one of them was the Yanobo fight.
The other thing is that Molduga, you can fight with arrows, or you can fight by diving.
Oh yeah? Nice.
Not Molduga, what is the other one?
Colgara?
Colgara, that's it.
Yeah.
Colgate.
Yeah, I was gonna say, it still sounds like a medication or toothpaste to me.
Minty fresh. Ice cold. Colgate.
You know, one time I tried a cinnamon toothpaste. Man, that was really good. Why doesn't that idea catch on? Well, you're not feeling it? Fine. Mine more
for
me.
That sounds awesome. I don't like toothpaste that tastes like anything.
No, I loved it. I wanted to put it on my cupcakes and just eat it.
Ugh.
Now you just try to cross them out.
Yeah, I'm just messing with you. But the cinnamon toothpaste was real, though.
Yeah, I don't want toothpaste to taste like anything.
Well, Miller, I just don't know what to tell you then.
Tell me that they sell flavorless toothpaste. Oh, wait, they do.
Yeah, I think they do. I've never really minded the whole minty fresh thing.
I know they sell flavorless toothpaste because that's what I buy.
Oh, did you go? Okay.
Yeah, Argus says, cinnamon on my tongue is good. Cinnamon on my gums is not.
Fine. I'll just keep my thing in your face.
You can have it all for yourself.
Oh yeah, I'm gonna hoard it. So I'll set up my mountain of cinnamon toothpaste. And just be like, yeah.
You'll hoard it like those hand soap hoarders at the beginning of the pandemic. You'll have 13,000 bottles of cinnamon toothpaste, and then it'll all completely devalue.
Never know, and there might be a cinnamon toothpaste shortage. Uh-huh. You know, the butt with all the cinnamon toothpaste might get stuck in the Suez or something. Simon says there's vanilla flavored toothpaste. It was the best thing ever, but they stopped making it. That does sound pretty good.
I used to love the creamy Italian dressing. I would dip my pizza in that when I was a little kid. I love that. And then they stopped making creamy Italian.
Did they stop?
By the time I was like 10.
Did they stop making creamy Italian?
Shit. I could never find it anymore at the grocery store.
Oh, you got a point there. I'm trying to remember last time I saw it.
Really? I was doing that when I was eating mostly like DiGiorno and Domino's, and really what was happening is I was just covering up the taste of cardboard.
Nice.
Two balls!
Alright.
Frederick says the worst is when you get toothpaste flavored food. Yep, that's why I don't like mint chocolate chip ice cream.
Mint ice cream doesn't taste anything like mint toothpaste to me.
Yeah.
You add sugar to it, it's a completely different flavor.
Tarani makes a coffee-flavored coffee syrup. I'm kind of one of these days I'll try that.
I'm sorry, coffee-flavored coffee
syrup? Coffee syrup, as in it's like it's the syrup you put in the coffee, you know, you do a little squirt.
But it's flavored
coffee.
Like coffee.
Coffee.
But,
What? I don't know.
What does that even do that, like, just putting sugar into normal coffee wouldn't do?
Miller, I don't know. Coffee syrups are strange, mystical, arcane.
That's wild.
Land. There's a coffee syrup flavor that's like unicorn. I mean, what the hell's that?
Well, clearly it tastes like unicorn. Yeah, there you go.
Like a
there.
Horse, a horse with a horn protruding out of its head. Yeah, that's what it tastes like. Hold on, let me get the coffee syrup link so that you... I'm not just making this up.
I mean, if they want to make it accurate, then what it would actually taste like is rhino.
Like rhino! Yummy!
Supposedly, that's where the myth of the unicorn came from.
Oh, I believe it.
They're like, it's like a horse, but it has a horn on its head. They're like, yes, let me draw that.
And then they, get it completely wrong.
Mm-hmm.
There, I posted it. Coffee-flavored coffee syrup. Or coffee liqueur.
Coffee liqueur flavoring syrup. That's not coffee-flavored syrup.
Okay, but
it's coffee liqueur.
Hold on. Fine. Hold on. Let me find another... 1 second.
You can find me some actual coffee-flavored coffee
okay,
syrup.
Okay, here. There,
that's coffee liqueur. That's what you put in alcoholic drinks to make them taste like coffee. Okay, Tarani, coffee syrup, not coffee liqueur.
There.
That's still coffee syrup that you put in alcoholic drinks. It's not coffee-flavored coffee syrup.
You could put it in your...
Okay, you know what, that's on you then. If you're putting that in coffee, that's on you for being insane.
It doesn't have any notice that says I can't put it in coffee, Miller.
It is illegal.
Okay,
right?
You know what?
Section 242
okay, you know what? I'm gonna,
of the International Coffee Law.
All right. Well, I'm just gonna have to be a rebel then. I'm gonna get some of the stuff. I'm gonna have a video of me putting a big dash of it in my coffee and drinking it, and then I'll just be like, "This one's for you, Miller."
Uh oh. He's dunking you, Miller. He's
I expect this video in my email by tomorrow morning. Get on it, Jonas boy.
All right, fine. Challenge accepted. Marcus Villa says coffee liquor is not coffee flavored. Yeah, well, near your face.
That was close. I still want that chest up there. Not sure how to get it.
I think you were close on the right idea, making like a staircase sort of thing.
I don't drink coffee with booze in it. That's not to say I never have, but I don't like that combination. Like, someone suggested coffee with Fireball whiskey in it one time, and I tried it.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, I mean. Looks like you're making a molecule.
Basically.
Making a molecule? Oh, I see.
Yeah.
Sorry, I thought you were still talking about your coffee combinations.
Yeah, it's
like, yes, this coffee I put molecule. Together, it's like a molecule.
Molecular coffee.
Oh, yeah.
The best kind of coffee.
You know, I've seen coffee. There was this trend of, like, putting, like, medium chain triglyceride butter in your coffee or some shit. Like, to get, like, I don't know.
Fudge?
Like, it's supposed to be, like, a metabolism booster or something, and I'm just thinking, like, that's the nastiest sounding thing ever. I do not want butter in my fucking coffee.
Almost.
Getting there.
This is absolutely incorrect.
That's quitter talk. Actually, you're probably right. Look at it go! Look at it go! Fly, little buddy! I think you're on the right track.
I mean, I could just cheese it immediately, but I don't wanna.
Jeez! Everyone cheeses the shrine. Is this just a known term? Cheesing the shrine? Hey,
well,
man.
Cheese, yes. That's just a thing in video games. No, no, not for the shrine, but cheese in general is just a video game term.
So cheese means, like, coming up with, like, a cheap,
yes.
unintended solution?
Yeah, coming up with an unintended cheap solution that shortchanges what the developer actually wanted.
I never knew that.
Like, you've seen the video of the... What do we do with the circle block? Put it in the square hole. What do we do with the star block? We put it in the square hole. Like, that's akin to
that's
cheesing
exactly.
it.
It's cheesing when we do it. When speedrunners do it, it's pro strats. No.
Yeah, that turns too much.
Nope.
What if we skip the medium ball? It just goes down.
Okay. Yeah, it's just gonna sail off.
Huh?
Awesome work. Two mates to midnight.
Supposed to be.
Yeah, it's kind of, it's tricky because like, okay, so the slope is okay. Right. So that's not, it helps to get a little perspective on that, definitely. Because I would have not seen that funny angle from up top.
I should be able to get it. This. It's very close. Side, bring it farther down. Still doesn't look like it's even getting anywhere close to that. Oh well, I'm done. I tried.
You definitely put in, you know, gave it the old college try.
Mm-hmm. The old college spit.
Yeah, that one's just kind of tricky because it requires the physics engine to cooperate with you in a most particular way. Like, I think you were literally doing the right thing, like the developer intended thing, and it just wasn't giving you the solution that it needed to. Which, that's disappointing when that happens, but...
You know, when I think of the whole cheating thing, I think of like that one scene in Raiders where like, you know, the swordsman's jumping out and Indiana Jones is getting ready to fight him, and the swordsman's doing all the crazy sword shit, and he's just like, you know what, fuck this, and he just takes the pistol and blasts him.
Yeah, kind of. It's just like, look, all I need to do here is win. Nothing else really matters. I just need to get this over with as quickly as possible. Phyllis says, I love that he apparently ad-libbed that scene. What do you mean ad-libbed the scene? Like he was supposed to sword fight the guy and then Harrison Ford decided, no, I'm gonna shoot him instead?
I think that is...
Yes, because Harrison Ford had a fever that day.
Yeah.
I think it was ad-libbed in the sense of he asked, can I just shoot the guy? I don't want to do the sword fight.
I think that was improv though, wasn't it?
Well, I mean, that counts as improv.
Yeah.
It wasn't in the script.
Yeah. He was just lucky that the guy that was doing the sword fight caught on.
Yeah, you know.
I mean, I hope he was
gonna... pulled out a real gun and shot him. Thank God he was strapped with his bulletproof vest that day.
Yeah, they figured out what they were going to do beforehand. They just decided on the spot to just not do the sword fight.
No, I like this idea more that Harrison Ford actually just shot a man and hoped he was going to survive it.
Exactly.
He's just like, walk it off.
Eh, he'll live.
He'll be all right. I've had worse. God.
Time to make a pizza.
Alright. That's the best way to end an adventure.
Pizza.
Right, what can I add to the pizza that still keeps it pizza?
Monster guts.
Fuse the pizza with another pizza. Make a pizza.
Obviously, you add mushrooms. Make mushroom pizza. I don't know. No, that makes mushrooms too. You got it too wet. Now you just made it into stew.
Nice.
This is the game being like, no, it's not Chicago style, it's a tomato stew in a bread bowl.
You can add other fruit to pizza, obviously, bananas.
Yeah, do it Swedish style.
British? I've heard that's Brazilian style, is banana pizza. By the way, Chad, don't ever go look up banana pizza if you want to retain your
your sanity. I don't know what the fuck the Brazilians are making, but it is not pizza.
Okay, you add fruit to pizza, it's still pizza. I don't think you could add a truffle to pizza and it still be pizza.
Tomatoes or fruits?
Are we having pizza destroying topics? I can't stand for this.
Frederick says dark clump rice salt. I think we did one of those yesterday. Yeah, we did one of the dark recipes.
Yeah.
Dark stew.
That was dark clump meat fish. Okay, so we don't have the one that Frederick's talking about, dark which is clump. Yeah.
Rice.
You just break the studio? Cool. That's good.
Warping dark rice ball.
Now you can eat the abyss with your hands.
Yay. What I've always wanted.
Did Clip Studio just crash on you, Jonas?
No. It just really like locked up for a good solid couple of seconds there.
Yeah, let's try to see if truffle can be added to pizza in order to make hearty pizza.
There you go.
I doubt
it. Make sure to save often. You don't want to lose those fennec tatas.
No. I'm not working. I'm working on a different one right now. But I have autosave turned on, so that's not an issue.
Nope, that's mushrooms too. Okay. Ah well.
Oh, goodness gracious.
You said it, buddy.
You don't say.
Thanks, everyone, for coming out.
Yep.
I'll be joined a delicious topic. Caffeinated topic.
I'm out of ready right tonight.
2 dozen left.
All right, well, snappy closing line, and promise for more on a future occasion.
Yay.
Yeah.
Have a good night, everybody.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.